Am I?
He probably lives on the west.
You now have quorum.
Okay, so we're ready to start, councillors. So the next item on the agenda is item six, with the Cobham Drive, Wairere Drive Ring Road connection, which is on page 165. So Chris, I think, you know, this is, I think the report is clear about what it is that you're proposing to do, and you have had some discussion, I think. Was this briefed, or?
Yeah, we did talk about it in the briefing.
All right, okay.
We're happy just to answer any questions.
I think so. Okay, so councillors, questions on this report. Councillor O'Leary, then Councillor McPherson.
I'll let Councillor McPherson go first. I've just got to find my place in my...
Yes, Chris, I take it from the diagrams that we're now seeing and with an example on page...
What page are you
at? Yeah, I just was giving the page, Your Worship.
Oh, is it this pull-out?
Well, if you let me just get a word in edgewise, I'll tell you. Page 176.
Yeah. 176, yeah.
As an example, that we're now going for four lanes on the first section of Wairere Drive through to Cambridge Road, from Cobham Drive through to Cambridge, page 176. Despite the huge justification that staff gave us a couple of years ago as to why it should only be, at this stage, single lane in each direction.
So Councillor, I think the diagram that you're looking at is a concept diagram. So there are still constrictions on the land on the East Town Belt to build to four lanes, but what we wanted to do was just show the ultimate, structure that would that could go on the site. The work that ahead of us would be to look at the scoping and come up with an actual design, but we do still have that limitation on the land on the East Town Belt that would prevent the four lanes going right through to Ruakura Road. I think councillors have previously...
No, well, I wasn't talking about Ruakura Road, I was just talking about through to Cambridge.
Yeah, through to Cambridge Road, sorry. Through to Cambridge Road.
Well, when you say indicative, do you mean all those cycle paths and all the other lanes and that are also all indicative? I mean, what's definite about this plan that you want us to support you going to NZTA for, and what's just indicative? I mean, I can understand things moving a few metres either way, but I think it's quite a qualitative difference, a four-lane road as opposed to a two-lane road. That's, I would hope, a bit more than indicative.
Yep. So the plan that you see in front of you is exactly the option that's been proposed to go forward as a result of the report. This plan has been developed through the whole of the Southern Links designation and essentially forms part of the Southern Links designation. The four lanes that you can see heading up north up the page, it's unfortunate we just cut it off a little bit, but it was always envisaged by Southern Links that it would be four lanes south of the Cambridge Road intersection. So that was always part of the
hang
proposal.
On, when you say that, Andrew, yes. you've got the diagram there of the roundabout option, which is what's currently approved, which only shows two lanes. So when you say it's always assumed that it's four lanes, that doesn't equate with the one on page 175, shows only two.
To be clear, I was referring to the Southern Links designation, which is the drawing on page 176.
Sorry, Andrew, what page number?
176. So that drawing is from the Southern Links designation that's recently been finalised. The drawing on page 175, which is the roundabout, is an option that fits within the Ring Road designation, which is a different designation, has a different footprint and a different set of constraints. The purpose of this report is to seek a direction from Council as to whether we should take a longer-term strategic view and progress with the Southern Links option as opposed to the earlier Ring Road designation option.
And was not something that was strongly suggested at previous council discussion on this, that we take the longer view and that we go, for instance, for the grade separation and the four lanes?
So there's certainly been a lot of discussion about the four lanes, and that is, I think it's south from Ruakura Road, and that's where we've got the impact on the East Town Belt. So
no, particularly at this intersection point. I'm happy to get out some of the tapes of the meeting, if you like, Chris. We never looked at maps up to Ruakura. We looked at maps of this, the southernmost bit, the currently incomplete bit only.
Yeah, but so, I mean, what's your sort of point?
Well, okay, point,
it might have been discussed in the past. But
I'm trying to discover what's caused the sea change in staff's view, other than the new NZTA funding that seems to be available.
Yeah, all right. So let's ask it like
that. Test the technical sort of understanding here.
All right, so let's ask it direct like that.
Yeah.
What's caused
I've already informed the general manager beforehand the subject.
So what's caused this change of recommendation? And is it more than the fact that there may be a $1 billion fund that we could access?
So, I thought that was a different question than Dave's, but why we're looking at this option now is two reasons. One is that we've been looking at the roundabout option in the bridge and the cost of building that, and the costs are higher than our budget. So that's forced us to put this option back on the table to have a look at. So the two variables were the cost of building this, but also the timing of opening up Peacock Stage 1. Mm-hmm. So the roundabout option at best was always going to be an interim option to the period of time when Peacock Stage 2 was open. So growth is certainly accelerating a lot quicker at the moment than we anticipated, which leads us to believe that Peacock Stage 2 might need to be opened sooner rather than later. Mm-hmm. There's also the opportunity of the $1 billion fund, which was still progressing. If I come back to Councillor Dave's question, I think what Andrew, just reiterate what Andrew said. So with the roundabout, we were looking at a narrow designation for that the Ring Road had. When we've gone and designated the Southern Links options, we've included this bridge as a different designation that comes on top of the roundabout. So the roundabout fitted within the Ring Road designation, but the Southern Links designation was for this big bridge. And I think that designation went up to Cambridge Road. It tied the bridge into Cambridge Road. But between Cambridge Road and Ruakura Road, there's still a two-lane bit of road, and that constraint was because of the
East Town Belt. That wasn't being asked about, that bit. Only the bit that hasn't been yet completed. So you're talking about the extra funding available. The table on page 168 shows that the extra project costs, the difference between the current agreed option and the proposed one in here, is between $14 and $22 million extra, depending, I guess, on which part of the cost range your tenders end up in. Forgive me for suggesting, but I don't think the public really cares whether it's a Ring Road designation or a Peacock's development designation. They just care what's available for them to use in terms of public facility. And they would have seen, had we gone ahead with the roundabout, correct me if I'm wrong, $90 million spent on a roundabout, which would somewhere between 10 and 20 years have been dug up and replaced with a thing that only cost $10 to $14 million more.
Correct.
So the cost effectiveness of that would have been questioned by a lot of people. Let's say I would say a lot of reasonable people.
Yeah. It sort of the 15 to 20 years. It's probably cost effective to build the roundabout, but if you're bringing that period closer, it certainly makes the bridge a much more sensible option.
Okay.
To do.
So talking about the growth happening faster than anticipated, has this not been something that's been raised at this council for probably the last 9 years, that the growth projections that NZTA's been using, that we had previously used, have been too low and that we should be going with high growth projections?
We sort of every year we do our 10-year plan, we make decisions on what growth scenario we're going to use, and they have been increasing over the last 10-year plan.
And we're still behind, we're still growing faster than what has officially been accepted, which has meant that things like the roundabout that was there for 2 and a bit years in front of the base had to be replaced about 3 years after it was built. And this, fortunately, has been anticipated in time. It just makes me wonder whether there are, Chris, whether, and you might like to comment on this, whether there are other major transport projects which we're doing half-baked jobs on, because that's what the growth projections that we have in front of us are suggesting at the moment, and we're actually costing the community a lot more in the long run.
Look, we use the best information in front of us at the time.
That's an answer, okay. I guess, Dave, you know.
That'll do, thanks.
That's the answer. All right, Councillor O'Leary, you ready now? You found your notes?
I've got a lot of questions, oh, Your God. Worship. I know. So Dave's just ticked one off for me. But just on page 165, I just want to be clear, because right through the report, you talk about bridge, and there's the pedestrian bridge plus the new Waikato bridge, and so I just want to make sure I'm getting the gist of it. So page 165 on point 7 there, you've said subject to NZTA approval that existing funding for the ring road portion, which is the decision we've already made, may potentially be reallocated if we went for the, I'm going to call it the gold-plated version. So have you had conversations with NZTA, or is that just wishful thinking?
No, we've certainly had preliminary conversations with NZTA, which have been positive.
Yeah.
But until we package it up, and that's the work that we're asking Council to do, package it up and put it in an application, we don't have a definitive answer, but certainly our discussions have been very positive.
Okay. Page 166, point 22, you've said there the cost of the roundabout and associated pedestrian cycle bridge, together with the need to progress peacocks, etc., means early construction of the medium to long-term vehicle overbridge is worthy of consideration. What's the medium to long-term vehicle bridge? Are you talking of, but you're talking about the new river bridge that's proposed in the...
Yep. So that was a reference to the work ahead of us to look at the new bridge on... You know, on page 176, the work ahead of us is to look at whether there are staging options and whether it would be more cost effective to build a bridge that didn't have all the lanes or did have all the lanes. But
a traffic bridge. Can we say pedestrian bridge? Traffic bridge.
Yeah, the traffic bridge.
It'll be easier, yeah. The traffic bridge. And we've got $85 million in the long-term plan. Well, actually, it's outside of the current long-term plan, in years 11 or 12 or something, $85 million for that traffic bridge.
That's effectively correct. So it's not in our 10-year plan. It's anticipated in the infrastructure strategy.
Yeah.
Anticipated in those years, sort of 10 to 15.
So why are you calling that traffic bridge, proposed traffic bridge, medium to long-term?
It was just a reference to say that when we do our design, we would look at options to see whether there was a staged options towards the picture that you're looking at. Now, it might very well be, and for the reasons Councillor McPherson has just said, that we would just build the right bridge first time. But
traffic bridge.
The right traffic bridge at the first time. So if you look at, for instance, the bridge you're looking at, would we build the four lanes or would we build two lanes for a 20-year period and make it so you could upgrade the four lanes later on when you needed it? But it's work ahead of us to have a look at that to see whether it's sensible. It might not be sensible to do that. It might be sensible just to build what you're looking at in the picture.
Yeah. Page 167.26, and again, I'm just trying to clarify some of the wording in the report. It says the Southern Links designation provides for a traffic ped cycle bridge over Cobbin that connects to a second bridge across the river. The second bridge is the traffic bridge, right?
No, sorry, what?
It's not another bridge. 26, page 167. 26. It's just where it seems to be the report's using different words and languages for what I think is a traffic bridge and a pedestrian bridge.
No, sorry, I've really confused you.
Yeah.
So what I'm talking about, if you talk about moving into the Peacock Zone and you're coming down the ring road, so this bridge that we're looking at now will be a bridge over Cobham Drive. and you'll go into the gardens area.
It's an overpass, Councillor O'Leary.
The overpass bridge, vehicle bridge over Cobham Drive. And then you will come to another bridge that goes over the Waikato River. And that, then you're on to the other side of the river and you're into the Peacock
South. So is that the bridge that goes over the gully?
It's the bridge that goes over the river.
Page 177.
I do have to say that you know, in some of these reports, try not to be critical here, consistency of language and colloquial use of words would be helpful, right? You know? Because I think the one over Cobham Drive is an overpass or overbridge, because that's what we know and the public know it to be.
Yeah.
Then there is a bridge over the river, the River Waikato.
Yeah.
So, and then there is a pedestrian bridge.
Yeah, there's three.
Yep.
Okay. So if you looked at page 177, Councillor.
Well, I looked at all of the pages. Yeah.
So if you're looking at page 177.
I guess at the end of it, what is your concern, Councillor? Maybe instead of series of questions, what is it at the heart of what your concern is?
Well, I was trying to get clarified what bridge we're talking about when we mentioned bridge in the report, because it wasn't clear.
Mm. Okay, so which bridge is the report about?
Well, it's about all of them.
So the bridge is the bridge. It's about the overbridge over Cobham Drive.
That's right.
Best seen by on page 177, where you've got your artistic impression of it.
Make it very clear, it's about the vehicle overbridge over Cobham Drive.
Correct.
It's also CEO. Pedestrians as well.
Yes, yes.
I think I've made my point.
Would it be the Chris Allen Memorial Bridge?
Okay.
Could very well be.
That's actually a point.
We'll call it the
Memorial
Bridge. But just to be clear, Councillor, this is a report about whether, you know, a change of plan from the roundabout joining Wairere Drive and Cobham Drive, and instead constructing an overbridge over Cobham Drive that will eventually link into a bridge across the river and into Peacock.
So there are two bridges in the report.
But this report is not about...
I understand that, but one of the decisions, your recommendation in this report is to do the gold-plated pedestrian bridge, which links strategically, that one of the reasons behind it is strategically because of the traffic bridge, proposed traffic bridge, the $85 million bridge.
So look, I'm clearly I've confused everyone, because the recommendation is not to build the gold-plated pedestrian bridge.
I don't think it was gold-plated.
The recommendation is not to build a roundabout and not to build a pedestrian bridge in conjunction with the roundabout.
Mm-hmm.
It is instead to build a traffic overbridge at Cobham Drive, which will include pedestrian and walking cycling facilities. So that bridge that we're proposing to build is the one on page 176 and 177.
Yep.
So that is, you can see Cobham Drive, you can see the overbridge structure on it in an engineering form on page 176. If you look on page 177, you can see the artistic impression of that overbridge. So there is no separate pedestrian bridge, and that's one of the key points. You do not need a separate pedestrian bridge, because this bridge would have walking and cycling facilities in it. And they are the blue sort of squiggle lines on the previous page. If you look on page 177 to the right, where you've got a little box that says future connection to Peacocks, that goes over the Waikato River, and we made reference in the report to that bridge, which would be part of opening up Peacocks. But the bridge that we're proposing, and we're asking you for approval to do some work on, would be a standalone bridge that would connect the ring road to Cobham Drive. It would work very efficiently on its own, but it is a stepping stone towards cracking into Peacocks. And so if we were going to open up Peacocks really early, it's very sensible now to build this bridge now and not have any sacrificial work. If we build a roundabout and we wanted to go faster on Peacocks, we'd have to take the roundabout much earlier than we expected and build this bridge anyway.
Okay, page 167. Thanks for that clarification, because I did not pick that up from the report, and I didn't think that it was clear in the recommendation either, but that's obviously my error. The timeline for The recommendation is 2020. Completion is 2020. So, which pushes it 3 years further out from what's currently on the table. Is the intention to connect Cambridge to Cobham for the traffic in the interim, or just do it all at once and therefore residents are going to have to continue turning left onto Cambridge?
The latter. So it would be not to do any more work until we build this bridge and we make the final connection. So for a 2 to 3 year period, the ring road would continue to operate as it is operating now. In our opinion, it is operating okay at the moment. We'd have to monitor that and look at that and maybe make some small changes, but it's operating okay for the next 3 years, for the period of time until this bridge was put in place.
So why rule that out, though?
Why rule out?
Why can't we finish Cambridge Road to Cobham Drive?
Yep. So
simple treatment on it, no, only turn left or whatever.
Yeah.
Like we've got Grey Street onto Cobham and other ones. Yeah. Why can't we do that in the interim?
Yeah, it's just not that simple. So there's a lot of reasons, like the topography, like we'd have to cut down the road to make the last connection and have a really big cutting down to the level of Cobham Drive, whereas we go for the bridge will just go over the top of Cobham Drive, and it wouldn't work very well traffic engineering wise and if we just put in a really low cost option. It needs a properly designed option to be safe, and the roundabout would do that. It's just the limited life of the roundabout as soon as you try and connect Peacocks onto it. Yeah, and everything we do would be sacrificial. So we'd spend $14 million to make the final connection and put the roundabout in. Then when we wanted to go into Peacocks, we would have to go and basically take that $14 million out and put the bridge back in over the top. So what we're saying is, we think at this point in time, with the prospect of Peacocks perhaps coming a bit quicker than we all thought because of the growth and maybe the opportunity of the fund, to just take a pause, get ready for the big bridge, and build the big bridge if the funding lines up.
The big bridge meaning the one that's in the report, not the future river traffic bridge.
With the overbridge, well, to be clear that if when council opens up Peacocks, you'd have to build both bridges. You'd have to build this one here, which we're proposing to build now because it's got a use on its own to connect up the ring road and function, but you'd need the other bridge across the Waikato River to reach into Peacocks. So what we're saying is this bridge could be built as standalone now. It would work really well, probably better than the roundabout, for just the ring road connection and all the ramps and everything. But it's just a lot more costly, which is why we'd gone for the roundabout. Certainly with the subsidy opportunity, it brings our council's share of the cost down quite a bit.
Okay, Councillor Leary, Transport Minister, have you finished your
questions? I'm going for Councillor McPherson's job. I thought he'd be quite proud of me actually today. I'll leave it for now.
Gosh. Okay. Good. Okay.
Worship, I'd like to move the recommendation.
Thank you, Councillor McPherson. Yeah, look, great. Thank you. Okay, so now I'm looking closely at the three over here who had their hands up.
Closely or hardly?
Okay, Councillor Forsyth, you did have a question.
Just one quick one.
Yep.
Now that Chris has added that extra bit on to explain what was going on. When you were talking about, you know, the sacrificial time frame, what sort of time frame are you talking about? So given the growth predictions, the new growth predictions, and the original roundabout, I remember the briefing we were talking about, well, that was originally going to last 10 to 20 years, but this was brought to the table because growth's coming forward. We think that time frame's going to be much shorter now.
Yeah, so So we proposed the roundabout on the basis that it would have a 15-year life.
Yeah.
So if we go quicker on Peacocks, it would have less than 15 years life. So it was just around the 15. So,
just less than 15.
So it really depends on when council makes a decision to invest in Peacocks, to open up Peacocks. So that's a big decision in front of council, and we know that it's right at the end of the 10-year period. So when you come to the next 10-year plan, it's going to be a decision that's right there in front of you of putting the funding in for that. There does appear to be an opportunity with the $1 billion fund, but
yep.
We don't know how that fund's working yet at the moment, but we're certainly interested in it, and I think Richard, CEO, coming back next month with what we know on that.
Yeah, so I intend to further discussion around growth overall, as well as what we know about the $1 billion fund, at a briefing in August, as well as the council meeting in August. And I'm hoping, from what we know at the moment, that we'll at least be able to indicate to the government what our intentions are to that before the end of this term.
Yep, fair enough. And just one other small question. So if we take this option and build the overpass, it means that you will still be able to access, obviously, Cobham Drive. You don't actually need... It'll still be effective in its own right. You don't need the bridge over the water.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
So you'll go over the overpass, you'll take an off-ramp, and then you'll circle around and join Cobham Drive.
Yep.
Okay, cool. That's
Councillor Gallagher.
Yes, just so clear, Councillor McPherson's point. Bridge, capacity for four lanes, built to have four lanes of traffic, correct, and the appropriate turns and all that. So it's a four-lane bridge, and then the option which you're going to come back to us is whether, in fact, we four-lane now, at least to Cambridge Road, in terms of the cost and design.
Yeah, so all of that would come back to council. Like, the decision we're asking council today is to utilise the money that we've already funded for Southern Links. So we've got a Southern Links fund which is all about enabling Southern Links. It's to do environmental mitigation, to buy the odd property and do works and preparations for Peacocks too. So we're asking you for approval in one of the resolutions to use that funding to develop this bridge up option up into a conceptual design. So you're not making a decision to build it, you're making a decision for us to go and do some work about what it looks like and how much it'll cost, and that will then start aligning, I think, with the 10-year plan decisions and aligning with the $1 billion fund opportunities. So it'll be a future decision of council to proceed or not, and what it looks like, whether it's four lanes, two lanes. But we would have all of that information.
Taking the two diagrams, if you like, at face value, and I know there's the print description, but very clearly what you're coming back to us is a bit like the Piketty Bridge, is it will have capacity structurally for eventual four lane across it.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
Okay, good.
Yep.
And also, you will come back and you will scope whether or not the project may or may not include four lanes, at least to Cambridge Road. Is that correct?
Yeah, all of that information will be there for you to make a decision on.
And then what I want, eventually, is the further discussion around the Cambridge Road to Ruakura. Now, that may be a separate, probably a separate report. So from Cambridge to Ruakura is two lanes, right?
Yeah.
And the point at which part of that may become 1+2 or a la the boundary road bridge type. You know, in other words, starting to scope traffic capacity and all of that in the medium term. Is that an understanding of where we're going in terms of the,
yes,
if you like?
Yes.
Yes. Right. Okay. Councillor Young?
Yep. Just a couple of questions. For page 175, the original roundabout, I call it like a three-ways roundabout, okay? But can it make it into a four-ways one to extend it to further connect it with the bridge over the river? Or
no.
Can that be done? No.
No.
Because of the landscape or...?
Topography.
Yeah, just the topography, geography and capacity of the roundabout. No, we've looked at that and it won't sustain much growth from Peacocks.
All right. And the second question on next page 176, I know it's the indicative plan, but let's say if I want to come from the north by Wherry Drive, if I want to turn right back to the city, can I do that?
Yes, You can. So you'd go over Cobham Drive and you'll see a right turn lane that you'd sit in, and then you'd go onto the on-ramp. It's a bit much like it, you know.
That's on the other side of the road, is it?
Pardon?
From the north,
if you're coming from the north.
Yep. And then you turn right.
You'll drive right over Cobham Drive and you'll see a right turn lane sitting on the other side.
Come in here. And then if you're from, okay, yeah, got it, yeah. And then from Hillcrest, if I go to Ring Road up north.
Yep. Yep, so you'll come off the off ramp up to there.
Yep, sorry.
So we've still got the detailed design of how that would actually work, and might be signals or something like that. So it's a pretty standard
overbridge. Thank you. Yep.
Right. Are there any more questions, Councillor McPherson? No, Councillor Tooman.
The way I see this, Chris, is this is really to enhance Peacocks, because you've got an expressway which is going to open in 2019. Do you know, or has there been any traffic modelling done to see what the capacity of Cobham Drive will be once the expressway is open?
We know we have constraints in Cobham Drive, and probably the biggest one at the moment is down to the Cobham Bridge, the duplication. So part of Southern Link's projects was to look at the Cobham Bridge duplication and sort out some capacity issues in there. Mm-hmm. So there is modelling that's looking at how the whole network would work with Waikato Expressway and the Ring Road.
So is it envisaged then that Cobham Drive will have a reduced flow once the expressway is open?
No, I don't think that's the case, because I think it's because people don't want to bypass, they want to come into Hamilton, so the traffic flows are still going to be really high in the city, particularly getting to the west of the city. So the bypass would certainly help with the problem, not making the problems worse in the city, but it's still, you know, we are where people want to go. They want to come into the city.
We'll see.
They want to come here, Councillor Tooman.
Yeah, a bit like Taupo, though, Your Worship.
What are you comparing Hamilton?
No, everybody bypasses Taupo now because it saves you about 20 minutes.
Right. Mm. And are you comparing Hamilton to
Taupo?
No. I hope not.
Just that everybody wants to travel by the shortest available route, that's all.
You weren't intimidated by the mayor then, were you?
Well, you know, I think we're three times the size at the start.
Six
times the size. Okay. Right.
Size doesn't matter. For yourself.
I'm not answering that one. Right, now, Councillor McPherson has moved the motion and Councillor Wilson has seconded it. Now, Chris, was this the one that needed...
No.
No?
No.
Okay. So,
you're going to tell us what that is?
Yeah.
No, that's, what was it that it did?
No, that's for the Ruakura paper coming up. Wrong paper.
Oh, no, please not.
What bridge are you talking about now?
Yes, that's right.
It was a clarification.
Okay, so the motion is the one that is on page 166, which is basically endorsing the staff's recommendation. Right, so Councillor McPherson, you wish to speak to it?
Yes, please. Look, I think this is one of the biggest no-brainers we've had. I think it's been a no-brainer for a while. I'm glad the staff and NZTA have caught up with that. I think for 15% more, we're saving ourselves a hell of a lot of money in the long run by going ahead with this. I think it enables us to put in an application to this new $1 billion infrastructure fund before Auckland gobbles it all up. You've probably heard the stories that their needs are far greater than the fund that's there, and if we don't get in quickly, it'll be all gone, it seems. And I don't always agree with the government. I certainly think that's a good thing that they've done, but it'll only be good for us if we can get our hooks into some of it. And this is very much a project that's going to improve the amount of residential space that becomes available within our city. It ticks a lot of boxes. It future-proofs the city. Instead of making us look stupid in about 7 or 8 years when we dig up a roundabout that we've spent sort of $80-odd million in doing and a pedestrian overbridge that there were we've been arguing about for 16 years so far and still haven't done. It rolls it all into one solution. It gives both pedestrian and cycle links there. It's the traffic overbridge. It's going to provide better connectivity for people coming in from the south to the west. And there's going to be two options now to go west. If you want to go to the industrial area in the northwest of the city, you can either turn right there and go north along Wairere Drive on a good intersection, not a crazy roundabout, or you can go straight ahead and to the west and over the Cobham Bridge. That's going to split the flow of traffic. It's going to help us in most respects, I'd suggest. It's also going to clearly fast-track the potential for peacocks, and I think that's something we've been struggling with for quite a while. It's going to mean that the next step for city arterial development is clearly the Peacocks Bridge and opening up that whole residential area, and I think that it's an absolute no-brainer. My friend Councillor Blind Freddy has seen this for quite a while, Chris, and he's glad that he's been able to convince you.
Right. Okay, I'm going to go to Councillor Blind Freddy now because they have their hand up.
Glad, because I don't know who Blind Freddy is.
Correct. You're paying attention, Councillor Mutt. That's fantastic. Councillor Gallagher, I think I have
yeah. Compliments to Chris.
Blind Freddy.
Compliments to Chris and the team, and I think this is where your collective experience and, you know, in this area that you now agree with Councillor McPherson, and that's good that you've come to that that perspective. But also and acknowledge Councillor McPherson being one of the fathers or mothers of the of this whole wonderful arterial, and that's true because it's about political leadership, and the political leadership is going to exercise itself today. Because obviously the political leadership is that the city is making a very clear statement to central government of commitment ultimately to Southern Links and ultimately to the ongoing development of the Peacocks and Tamahere areas, particularly Peacocks, our Peacocks growth cell at this stage. So this is quite a significant vote around this council table today, because we are making a very clear development statement, because we do not see this bridge to be called the bridge to nowhere. It actually will be the bridge to Peacocks, and it will, of course, complete the job in a better way of Cobham Drive and the Wairere Drive arterial. What I will be looking for when that report comes, I want to renew that whole debate or dialogue around the capacity of Wairere Drive, and particularly the potential capacity or constraints, you know, from Ruakura Road through to Cambridge Road. And there may be some innovative ways in which, you know, in the next few years we could address that particular capacity. The bonus, of course, is the cycleway and walkway connections, both to the East Town Belt, to the Hamilton Gardens, and eventually to the Peacock Growth Cell. So this is also a wonderful future proof if you look at the map and the design, and actually, in my view, gives us a better cycleway, I think, walkway connection than even the roundabout proposal, which in reality was always going to be a temporary construct, as Councillor McPherson said. And finally, albeit we're getting an overbridge, there is still an opportunity, colleagues, to make that overbridge a feature in the sense of some of the signage and railing on it, so that when you come towards that overbridge, you'll have all the directional signing, but hopefully there will be significant mention of Hamilton Gardens, and you are, as a motorist coming into Hamilton, there will be a sense not just of either going on into the city or turning to go along the eastern arterial, you will actually have a sense of entry to the area, and particularly I do look forward to some themes that may really underscore that go straight under the bridge and you are about to turn off to Hamilton Gardens. So I think, in my view, long-term planning, long-term investment, and good vision.
Councillor O'Leary.
Thank you, Worship. Yeah, it is a no-brainer, like Councillor McPherson says, and actually I recall along with Councillor McPherson and Councillor Blind Freddy being one of, and I'm not too sure, I can't recall what the Deputy Mayor's position was, but being in the minority years ago when we tried to get peacocks under the spotlight and get peacocks going. So yeah, this is a no-brainer. And finally, in a very non-roundabout way, we're advancing that area of the city and not continuing. Yes, it is. Right. Thank you for getting it. And continuing to grow to the north. This is a fantastic decision.
Grow to the south?
No, that we're not continuing to always grow to the north.
Yeah. Right, any other speakers? Yeah. Councillor King?
It was just 3 months ago that we were sitting around this table and we were ready to vote on a walking bridge across Cobham Drive. This is a huge turnaround in a short time. And this is about opening up peacocks. This is a step towards fast-tracking peacocks. And I think there's about 7,000 odd sections over there that can be opened up in time. It's huge. But my big push on peacocks is about the struggling south, the social deprivation of the south, the empty schools, the closing the school that's closed over there, the rundown houses and the gang influence in that area. If we can get this area opened up, that area will become the place to be, the Baylett Street area for do-up houses, for houses to live in, close to the city, close to the hospital, and it's the beginning of a change for this part of the city, the forgotten part of the city, after 30 years of promises and zoning of an area that we haven't serviced and haven't looked into. So well done, Chris, and your team for this huge turnaround for a very small amount of extra spend.
Okay, Councillor Mallett.
Thank you. I want to support this. This is us doing exactly what we should be doing and doing it pretty well. So this is the reason I like being on the council.
Okay, I just want to...
And the Mayor says nice things about me, but that's...
I do support this motion. I just want to also point out to councillors that one of the good things about Chris and his infrastructure team, which is the largest component of the council's work, and let's not forget that, is that they aren't afraid to revisit, you know, recommendations that they might have made to us, even though they might get a bit of a grilling when they come back. And some of you who have been here a long time might, you know, reminisce about, you know, where that decision could have been made earlier. So I just want to say, yes, that's right, we were going to put a roundabout in. But what you've done is you're not in any way concerned about coming back and saying, you know, overnight I've had a rethink, actually, and I think we need to look at this again. So thank you for that, because that tells me that you're doing your job exactly how you should do, which is keeping your finger on the pulse all the time. Councillor McPherson, do you have a right to reply? No? Right, we're going to do it on the hands. All those in favour? Any against?
Well, this is dangerous.
Right. Okay, thank you. Now, the next report, councillors, the next item on the agenda is item 7, and it is an unfortunately entitled Drainage Reserve Part Sale Purchase Report, which is a very exciting title for a...
This is the stuff we're here for.
I know, but... So the drainage...
Ken's arrived just in time.
Ken has arrived in time, so this is... I think that this report is reasonably straightforward, councillors, so are there any questions?
I'll second.
Okay, so I've got it... moved by the Deputy Mayor and seconded by Councillor Forsyth, and Councillor McPherson's got a question.
I've got a couple of things. Right. Ken or Chris, when I look at the plan on page 182, the bit that's going to be sold here, it seems to include a chunk of building in there already. So are you saying there's a building on our land?
No, I think at the time that photo was taken, there was a container park there. So recent photos suggest that that it's gone when we last inspected.
Okay.
There. Yeah.
So they're nevertheless using the council land anyway.
They had been. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're regularising something that was happening anyway, really?
Yes.
Okay. So when I go to the valuation of 405 square metres at 40,000, and I think, I'd love to get 405 square metres for 40,000 anywhere in Hamilton City, especially for commercial. And it's land that's already flat enough to be used. It's not like it's in the gully, it's still on the edge of the gully, geographically. Can you explain the valuation?
Well, the valuation has been compared to other sales that have happened around Hamilton. The area itself is only 3.5 metres wide in terms of flat land, and so it's long and narrow. And part of the land is partially slopes down the bank.
But it's going to be aggregated, is it not, into the adjoining land, so it'll become one title, or...?
That's correct. So the land will be added to an existing title.
So the potential value of the land, let's say if you removed the building and just had bare land after that, will be as though it was one block 3.5 metres wider than it was to start with?
That's correct, yes.
So that suggests to me that there should be a valuation that reflects the sort of... the land value, not the incremental, the value of the incremental little driveway, let's say, but the value of the whole block divided by the proportion that the 405 square metres reflects?
So the valuation was prepared on the basis of the amalgamation, so of the land being amalgamated into the bigger title.
So if are you saying to me that the valuation, that a fair valuation of 405 square metres of commercial land in Hamilton City is only $40,000?
Well, that was the advice that we've been given by independent market valuation.
Based on amalgamation into the existing land that the purchaser will own as well.
Yeah.
So if someone had 1,000 square metres of land in a commercial area and it was valued... That would suggest that the valuation of that is only $100,000, which I would find, I'd find astonishing. I'd go borrow that money and buy it right now and on sell it within a couple of days and make a killing.
So I guess, Councillor McPherson, the answer to your question is whether we accept it or not is the valuation has been done and it's been based on the amalgamation into the other land mass. It does seem very cheap. Have you had it peer reviewed?
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you, we should have a second opinion before we go ahead.
Have you made inquiries with... that must have seemed cheap to you.
Well, I certainly looked at the evidence that he had provided in his report just to try and understand where the numbers had come from. And, he gives other examples for, coming to that rate per square metre. But there certainly is the opportunity to ask for either a second valuation or a peer review of the valuation we've got.
But isn't it a matter of the only person who can get value out of that land is the guy next door?
Correct.
And so there's only one person in the world. So Dave's point's invalid. It's kind of out of context because no one else can buy that. Anyone else can only buy that as a strip. The only person who can buy it next door.
That's not my point at all. My point is that the underlying... If you increase the current block, which is 900 square metres, add another 900 exactly, add another 405 to that, you're adding 45% to the size of the land. The valuation of the whole aggregated block is going to increase by a lot more than 40,000. I can see Gary's argument that only one person can use it, and you may want to discount it because of that. But I couldn't see that the difference between a 900 square metre block and a 1,305 square metre block of land in an industrial area or commercial area is going to be only $40,000 more.
So I think, this is the issue. So, Councillor McPherson, you can, change the motion if you want to. I'm going to go to Councillor Mallett now. Have you got a question?
Yeah, so just triggering off what Dave's saying, and I'm no valuation expert, and so I... acknowledge that. But anyone else who wants to buy that is only buying, can only buy a sliver of land, which has got a building right beside it, and is effectively, there is bugger all the district plan would allow them to do with that. They could do nothing but plant shrubs or something, wouldn't they?
Well, it's a very irregular, long shape.
Yeah, so that, look, and I'm not trying to get a, I'm not disputing what Dave said, but my point is, this is a very unusual situation where to do the valuation Dave's trying to do, I think, is actually totally out of context, because no one else can buy that. Yeah, no one else can get the benefit of the big thing unless they own the big the thing beside it.
I think that's all, it's all clear. It is what it is. And if people aren't happy with the valuation, they can address it through the motion. But if you've got some other questions, Councillor Mallard, or that was on the valuation.
Yeah, well, I'm just I'm asking, is that correct?
Yeah.
Our own district plan wouldn't allow for this to be cut off and put on the market anyway.
Sorry?
The rules of our own district plan would not allow a piece of land this shape to be subdivided and sold. It could only ever be amalgamated in.
Yes, that's correct. Okay. Right, so any other questions on this? No? So the motion's been moved and seconded. Did you have an amendment then, Councillor McPherson?
Yeah, I'd like to replace all of B through to E with a B that a peer review, that an independent peer review of the valuation supplied by staff be sought by staff and referred to the next council meeting.
Is it a peer review or another valuation? Peer review.
No, I think peer review, you don't need to get it.
So is there a seconder for that? Councillor Gallagher is going to second that, so we just make sure we've got the wording right. So that would be A, and then a new B. I'd just like to read it back when you've got it.
Is that who it is? Yeah.
Okay, the amendment's up there.
I guess, Your Worship, the assumption under B is along with the staff report, the current staff report comes back. So that's, I don't know whether you need to say that. That's the purpose of it, that it comes back as an extra piece of information with this report.
Okay, and brought back to the next council meeting with this report.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Can we just put the date for the next council meeting so we're really... Just being a bit anal, but it's just...
Of August, 29th of August?
To the council meeting of...
Okay, can everyone can see the amendment and the motion is the one as in the document. So... if you're going to speak on this, speak to, you know, with both of them. So the mover of the motion, do you want to speak on the motion? No? Anyone else wish to speak on this?
Yeah, I do, Your Worship. Look, what I would say is whether or not you agree with my suggestion that this effectively could give an unfair advantage to Sea Legs Limited, I think it's given that it seems to have surprised almost everyone around the table, the $40,000 valuation for 400 square metres of land.
you should at the very least be prepared to say, let's have another look at the valuation, let's get it checked. That's all that this says, checked by someone in the industry to see that that's a fair and proper figure for the ratepayers to get for this piece of land. It's absolutely true, looking at the diagrams, that only one organisation can use it. It's also absolutely true that they're already using it for nothing. So I think that they can bear waiting another month while we check it out. You know, if there's no way that it's worth more than $40,000, I'll be very surprised, but I for one would accept that result. But and we frequently, when there are doubts over property values, when something's being sold by council, go and get either a second opinion or a peer review. It's not unusual at all. And I might say, in my experience, in almost all cases we've done that, the final value that we've sold it for has actually been higher than the initial value that was suggested to us by a single valuation. But even if that's not the case, I think it's prudent for this council to check, because as far as I'm aware, a delay of 1 month is not going to affect things either way. I'm quite sure that Sea Legs will continue to drive their trucks or whatever down the back, and we won't. We'll continue to turn a blind eye for it while we're working out the final solution.
Right. Anyone else wish to speak? No? Okay, we're going to vote now. So we're going to vote on the amendment first. Those in favour of the amendment, please raise your hands.
Those for the amendment are Councillors Young, Gallagher, O'Leary and McPherson.
And those against?
Her Worship the Mayor, Hardacre, Councillors Chesterman, Forsyth, Pascoe, King, Green, Mallett and Tooman.
All right, we're now going to the motion. Those in favour of the motion, raise your hands.
Her Worship the Mayor, Hardacre, Councillors Chesterman, Young, Forsyth, Pascoe, O'Leary, King, Green, Mallett and Tooman.
Those against?
Councillors Gallagher and McPherson.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Right. Next item, item 8, page 183, approval of submission. So, councillors, there's been a lot of to-ing and fro-ing about these, so we got the submissions, then we got an extra thing, and as I understand it, Sean is going to tell us some further information about these submissions.
Thank you, Your Worship. So I'll take the report as read, and just to explain what we're looking at. So the submission document that was circulated on Monday, there's a number of recommendations in there, obviously. That's in essentially two sections, so page 1 to 5 of that document contains a summary of the recommendations in the submission. Then there's an appendix, which is essentially the rest of that document, which repeats those recommendations, but it also puts it in the context of the LGNZ and Solgum's positions on those matters. The Appendix 2 is a submission from PwC, and that covers various sort of tax and accounting issues, particularly in relation to CCOs. And then there's an additional document was circulated last night, which contained some changes to recommendations on development contributions. And that has been developed by, that's sort of been in consultation with the development consultations working group. But they are still working, or sort of were still working on their submission as at last night. So there is one of the recommendations that was circulated last night. The first one, which read that HCC supports the Development Contributions Working Group submission to the bill and will work with them in providing feedback and suggested amendments to the government. I am suggesting that as we haven't had that submission, we would struggle to support that at this meeting. But I would like to sort of suggest that we change that to the HCC supports the Development Contributions Working Group in working with the government to further refine the bill in respect of development contributions. So I'll can sort of sort that wording out shortly. As I said, there are sort of a number of kind of recommendations, and a lot of them are sort of technical and sort of cover a fair amount of legalese. I'm not going to go through each one, but happy to answer questions on them. There is one which I need to draw your attention to, which is section 2.3, I think it is. Let me just find the page. So 2.5, so it's on page 3 of the submission. And in here, with all the other recommendations, we have put a stake in the ground. This one here, we've left in two options for elected members to consider. This is relating to CCOs and whether they need to consult on the 10-year service delivery plan. That's effectively like our council's long-term plan. So for those particular services, it's whether the CCOs should have to consult the public on their 10-year plan. So I guess the argument against that is that part of the benefit of CCO is that they act more like a company, and it's perhaps more efficient if they don't. And the other argument is that because it is council services for essentially services for the public good, that they should consult the public as council would have to if they weren't in a CCO. And just further on that, so we have referenced Solgham's position in that. Solgham have changed their position in the last couple of days. So they now support the bill. So they now support option A, which is that CCOs shouldn't have to consult on their 10-year plan. So it is a bit of a moving feast. I sort of accept that and apologise for how confusing it may seem. I think probably the easiest thing to do is to take questions at this point.
Councillor Mallett.
Thank you. Sean, is there a definition for core services that provided core services? So you can have CCOs that do water, perhaps, and CCOs that run...
It's in the local government.
IT
services.
It's defined.
Oh, it is defined. And what are they? Are roading and water and things like that, are they?
Yeah, okay. It's in the local government.
Okay, so what would be an example of one that, like Whipple wouldn't be a core service, would it?
You know? No. I actually don't know the answer to that.
Okay, thank you.
No, it wouldn't. No, it wouldn't.
Okay, thank you. Now, just going to 3.2.2, which is requirement for polls. There's just a couple of double negatives in here, or sort of that make it difficult to understand. Hamilton City Council's recommendation that the bill is supported and proposed, i.e. a poll is mandatory, and this is about reorganisations of local authorities, that a poll is mandatory except for CCOs, and then should that again have and except where their reorganisation plan has the support of the effective local authorities, or should it not have that second except?
It should be or, I think. So the bill is supported as proposed, i.e. a poll is mandatory, except for... Oh, sorry, yep. So a poll is mandatory except for CCOs.
So stop there. So a CCO wouldn't be subject to mandatory consultation if they... a mandatory poll.
Mandatory poll.
A decision it made, like an amalgamation of CCOs. We're talking about amalgamations of CCOs, aren't we?
Or
reorganisations or something like that.
Yeah, so if it's a CCO, then the bill says that a poll is not mandatory.
And just stop you there. So even if it's a core service CCO?
If you have a look at page 17, which has a little bit more detail around that, so if the transfer is not major, it doesn't require a poll, or if it has the support of the local authorities, it doesn't require a poll.
Okay. So in order for not to have a poll, do two conditions have to be met? That it's a CCO and the reorganisation. So the CCO, the reorganisation, condition one, reorganisation involves a CCO. Condition two, where the reorganisation has been supported by the local authorities. Do those two conditions have to be met so as not to have a poll? Is that what that says? Is that what we're trying to say?
I believe so, but I just want to check okay. with George. Is it an and or more? Both conditions have to be met?
No.
One or other.
Okay. So one or other. Okay, so long as it's a CCO, or if the reorganisation has the support of the elected, when we say local authorities, we mean the elected members. Is that what that means?
So if it's, for example, combining services of two local authorities, then yep. both local authorities have to agree.
But hang on, local, I mean, we're getting down to that, which bridge are we talking about here? Council. Local authorities mean the elected members, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. Councillor
Pascoe? Yes, thank you. Questions around part three on the new powers of the Local Government Commission. My understanding is that this gives the Local Government Commission new teeth powers to come in and make councils do things. It says here expressly consult with the local authority. Does the Local Government Commission under this bill have any obligation to consult with communities? In the sense that, you know, you have a situation, I'm thinking of a situation here where you might have two or three councils wanting to get together to do a shared service or a CCO, and one of the councils decides that, for whatever reason, they don't want to be participatory in that. This, presumably, to me, gives the Local Government Commission the opportunity to come in and wield the stick at that LG local government.
Yes.
Do they have a requirement under this legislation to consult with the community, or only with the local authorities impacted?
No, just the local authorities.
Yeah. Okay. So, if I can direct that through you to our CEO, I understand this was an issue that was discussed last week at the local government conference, and there was a remit from, was it Waimate Council, opposing this particular change?
Yeah, so a remit was put forward by the Waimate District Council at a very late piece. It was accepted by the attendees at the AGM that could be heard, and the remit effectively said that LGNZ would vigorously challenge that principle, and from a view they wanted to encourage consultation with the community in any of these respects, and that was effectively passed by 98% of council's attendance at the AGM.
So should we be adding in another clause in here to take it perhaps where we've got the second dot point that they must expressly consult with local authorities impacted, whether we shouldn't add another line in there as another dot point that the LGC must expressly consult with the local communities who are affected by this decision?
I mean, that's really a matter for councillors to debate and decide, I guess. So that would mean that any reorganisation would have to go out for public consultation. So that's not current, that's not proposed under
the... And local government commission in the past have had to do that, haven't they, where they've looked specifically at amalgamations. They have had to consult with communities.
So to be clear, for amalgamations, so that the rules for amalgamations, that's sort of back to that polling question.
Yep.
So where that would be considered a major reorganisation, and so then a poll would be mandatory. So that's actually a referendum.
Yeah. But some of these decisions might also be quite major ones too. Thinking here of the waters decision, for example, that's a fairly major change if a CCO is formed. Not quite as major as an amalgamation, but certainly would have quite significant impacts on communities as well as the individual councils.
And LGNZ supported that, and if council wishes to have that put in, then that's council can choose to do that. That's your submission after all.
Okay.
Well, but this council also supported that, didn't they?
Yes. Oh, yeah, absolutely. From the straw poll that I did via email, it was supportive of Waimate District Council's submission. Yes.
So is it appropriate that I make that recommendation as a motion, or just ask Sean if he can add it?
You'll need to include that then, because that actually was what we supported at the AGM.
Okay. All right, and my other question, unrelated question, is about the PwC tax opinion. Is that something that we have... Is that something that we have specifically asked PwC for? So it is our submission and our submission alone, or is this collectively a tax opinion from PwC that other councils may well attach to their submissions too?
So it's PwC, but it's for Waipa, Waikato, and Hamilton City Council.
Okay. Okay. So that at least those other two councils will be adding this to their submissions.
Correct.
Yep, okay. All right, thank you.
If I can just add to that, councillors. So PwC will be presenting directly to the local government select committee on this particular issue, because it's quite a technical matter. Mm-hmm. But certainly it was commissioned as part of our joint process in terms of the proposed waters process, because there are some very important issues raised in there, particularly around the tax treatment of any proposed CCO in the future, notwithstanding the waters project.
Councillor McPherson.
Yeah, look, Sean, I'm looking on page 4 of the proposed submission, some of the points in yellow, and I really struggled to understand what the hell they meant. And I suggest that some members of the public would struggle a lot harder if they had to try and wade through it. 2.11.2, for instance, I don't understand what we're actually saying there. And the issue was, I understood, or one of the issues is whether CCOs are required to consult in a 10-year plan sort of type of way on the air. But I can't understand whether we're saying we're for that or against it in 2.11.12.
So in 2.11...
2, sorry. 2.11.2.
Yeah. So if you are able to flick through to page 13, Councillor McPherson. So that's where we have those recommendations and then some explanation of those as well. Essentially, what this recommendation is that the Section 8A sort of lays out powers that a CCO has. The anomaly in the bill as it's proposed is that if the CCO is developed through a local government commission-led process or a local authority-led process, that the powers under Section 8A aren't applied equally. And so our submission, or our recommendation in our submission, is that those powers under Section 8A should apply regardless of how the CCO is initiated, whether that be through local authority initiated or through commission initiated.
Okay, so you're saying if we've got a CCO, it should be required to act as though it's a public body anyway, regardless of how it got there.
So Section 8A confers certain...
No, don't worry about Section 8A.
Yep.
Just...
So what we're saying is no matter how the CCO is created, it should have the same powers.
No, not it should have the same powers. I'm talking about wanting to find out about what's the requirement on it, not whether it can do it, whether it must do it. Because I thought that was part of... Certainly some of the commentary I've heard, that seems to have been the issue. Is it required to consult the public on an issue, a significant issue, not may it? And this is all about having the powers to do that, but not the requirement. Yeah. And I don't understand that aspect either.
So that's actually, that's probably more pertinent to Section 2.5, I think, is probably the kind of the relevant piece there. That's where there's that question around whether CCOs should have to consult the public on their... on their plans.
It's page 3.
So so if I'm looking at 2.5.1,
yep.
You're saying, option A is saying that there shouldn't be a requirement for it to happen.
Correct. And then option B is saying that there should be.
Yeah. Yep. So, but doesn't that then apply to the other, flow on into the others? It just seems to me we're getting really technical on the clauses here, rather than that's not going to impress the MPs listening to this, because it may impress the officials,
because they may take that on board, but what you want to impress surely is what are our views on the big picture side of things. You know, what should we be getting MPs to take on board? MPs are just like ordinary people around here. They want to hear the argument in plain English, not in lawyerese. I mean,
okay.
Shouldn't we be saying, not dissecting the wording of individual things, saying this is the intent we think the bill ought to have. Let someone else work out the wording. And, you know, I don't see that. If we got a submission like this around our table about one of our bylaws, we would be saying, what the hell do you actually want to have happen at the end of it?
Agree. It's an issue we raise all the time.
You know, and I think we should be treating the MPs like that. We should be saying to them clearly, what do we want to have happen? Let your wordsmiths do the wording once you agree on the intent. I think we're trying to sort of almost write it for them with our submission, or parts of it. So, sorry, Your Worship, but I had trouble understanding because I didn't know what it was that we're trying to actually say here.
I mean, my view is I don't have any problem with us suggesting wording, but I think my views are well known. You know, submission's got to be compelling and advocate a position and be really clear and easy to read. Sorry.
And how, Your Worship, do we then decide, say, in 2.5 between option A and B? What's the process here we're following today? Because
well,
that seems
vote,
there's two
it?
Quite different strands of thought there.
I think ultimately it comes down, you're right, Councillor McPherson, to an intent point of view. I think, does this council fundamentally believe that regardless of whether or not the assets are owned by the council or by CCO, there should be a level of accountability to the public for major decisions associated with those assets? If that's what the intent is, that we believe that it's fundamental right of democracy for the community to have a say, then that's our intent, and we recommend the appropriate option to reflect that, and we can put the wording into the report.
We don't have to write the clause.
No, that's what I'm saying. We say our intent is, you know, for example, we want to encourage a democracy in all decisions in respect of creation of CCO, the powers that are associated with them, and their obligations to the community. That's that pitch you were after in terms of that conversation with the members of Parliament. Then we can ensure that the underlying detail is actioned accordingly. We can do that, but we can also make sure there's a summary, easy to read, understanding, covering document that achieves that, as well as a pitch to the elected member to the members of Parliament as well.
I'll vote on that one. We'll have to vote on A or B option.
Sorry, I did have another question. I mean, that's where I'm coming from.
Yep.
That definitely. Second point was just in relation to the polling. Under the current situation, because we've had one of only two councils that have had any sort of amalgamation since the Local Government Act came in, when Temple View came in, and there was no poll here or in Temple View, but there was a decision by White Park Council which was taken, and a counter decision by us, but White Park's decision was taken to the Local Government Commission under the current Act, and Hamilton got no choice. They had to accept the result. So are we proposing or arguing for something different from that? What's the practical effect in a situation? Because that's the sort of situation Hamilton might be faced. Should we take in a bit around this or not? And if there's a disagreement between the council's concern, which there was in that case, how is it handled?
Yes, I mean, that's not an amalgamation as such. So an amalgamation would be joining, you know, the Waikato councils together to form one council, which requires a mandatory poll. So that's, I guess, quite a different situation. In terms of bringing land from one region into another. I'm not sure. Do you know, Julie, what their answer to that is?
It's a transfer of responsibilities and functions
under
that.
No, it's a district
plan,
isn't it?
Got to come under district
plan. Yeah, it's a transfer of responsibilities, but it was one that this council opposed.
Blair, can you answer the question, please? What happens, you know, when we take land?
No, I just have a new question.
I'm thinking in relation to the new Act, yeah.
Sorry, can you just repeat the question?
So, you know, we've got...
Well, think of the Temple View situation. I'm using that as an example. It's a real one. We voted not to have Temple View come on board, and Waipa said, yes, it can, and so it was sent to the Local Government Commission, who said, yes, it will, and we got no choice then. And when I actually agreed
right?
with it.
So is the question...
There were no polls as such, which we're now... does this affect that sort of situation?
This bill affects a situation where there is neighbouring local authorities potentially wanting to expand or change boundaries or communities coming into that area, yes.
All right, okay. Partial areas of yes. other councils' boundaries.
Yes.
So this process would apply... So using the Temple View scenario for this, what's proposed in this bill, how would that have worked? Because as Dave said, it was... We did a poll, they did a poll.
No, sorry, we didn't do a poll, just a council decision, Your Worship.
We didn't want them, but they wanted to come to us, and the Local Government Commission said, yes, you're going to them.
I think it's probably a question for Sean to answer specifically, but the Local Government Commission under this bill would be involved and would work it through in terms of the requirements of the bill. So
what is the section in here that talks about that? Because, I mean, these are real live examples about what could happen. Does anyone know?
We had a word present.
The Local Government Commission has the ability to resolve disputes, so it would be the same process mostly as what happened on the current bill, it takes it back a step about who initiated the reorganisation.
Yep.
So the new bill proposes the ability for local councils to initiate reorganisations, which, for example, in that case, Waipa could have initiated that. And if Hamilton City had said no, it would have gone like it did in the previous situation to the Local Government Commission to resolve as a dispute. And they
so this essentially not really any change. Say Horsham Downs wants to come into Hamilton City, the residents there have some campaign and they come to us and say, will you take us? And we say we'd love to, but Waikar says, no, you're not, because we want to keep getting your rates. Then we... could take that, send that to the Local Government Commission for a decision.
And they can take it directly to the Local Government Commission.
Okay.
That's one of the new
extensions. Local Government Commission itself.
Yeah. I'm just trying to check how it would work in practice. Thank you for that. Yep.
Councillor Mallett?
Just my concern is the PwC tax thing. But I think it might be covered by the fact, again, gets back to page 2 of the tax thing, talks about definitions of what is core services. It talks there about recreational facilities, museums, community amenities. Now, clearly, there are a number of privately owned gyms, swimming facilities, and we now operate a small buying and selling of art, art sale by commission type of issue. Are you confident that, because it does talk about it's not taxable, it won't be non-taxable if it's competing with a private sector entity, and there are a heap of private sector gyms, and there would probably be more private sector run swimming pools in the city now than, I'm not sure, but wouldn't be far off it.
Not by litre.
Pardon?
Not by litre.
Yeah, they don't even pay for their water, do we? Yeah. We get free water.
Yeah, I mean, the intention of the submission is that where CCOs are created, which aren't competing in a commercial environment, that they aren't paying tax. So as if the service had stayed.
So in a situation like Club Aqua, which is a portion of a bigger facility, do revenues from Club Aqua, are they taxable?
No, because they're owned by the council.
Yeah, but that is definitely competing with the private sector, isn't it?
Yeah,
doubt about
so
that.
So, for example, if we were to create a CCO of Club Aqua, and then they would be liable for tax. If we create a CCO out of Waters or something like that, then the submission says that they should
be
liable.
Yeah, okay. All right. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so how are we going to do this?
With the recommendations in the report, can I just check from councillors, do you want changes made to the report based on that conversation?
We need to make the change that aligns with our position on the remit.
Yep. So, and that's the insertion of a bullet point under 3.1.
Can I suggest this following wording, that 3.11 that paragraph 3.11 include that the LGC must consult with communities impacted by the investigation. So that could go immediately under the line which says the LGC must expressly consult with the local authorities impacted by the investigation. So it could go immediately under that.
About both local commercial.
Oh, we could do it in one line. Yeah, we'll do it in one line. Yeah. Yep. And communities.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Happy with that. And affected. Does it say the word affected? Impacted.
Is communities a well-defined word? So that means residents, does it?
Yeah.
Residents, right, bars, businesses.
Those people on the electoral roll, I would imagine, on the cities, in our case, on the city's electoral roll, would be our community.
It's currently used, for instance, in Temple View, used, that was that community, there was a defined area that covered.
Okay, in terms of A and B?
We should have a resolution which is delete 2.51 or to delete 2.5.
So we're going to deal with that first, because I think it would be easier to do that, and then we'll pick up the rest. So
I'll move that 2.51 be deleted and we accept 2.52.
Okay. Seconder for that? Oh, Councillor Mallett seconding that. So 2.5.2 would be the
position.
We've
become 2.51 now, isn't it?
And 2.5.1's out. Is that right? Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so we're going to vote on that first, councillors. Are you clear? We're on page 3. We're looking at paragraph 2.5. And the motion is support for 2.5.2. Okay. Right, so we're going to vote on that with the hands. All those in favour, raise your hand. Okay, that's unanimous. Right, there we go. All right, so then the next bit is in the memo that was sent out, attached to the email yesterday, recommendation for text changes. So is that the motion? What motion do you want from us?
That the recommendations in the memo replace section 2.3 and the table on page 8. I'm not sure, it might be a question for democracy, does the full content of those things need to be included in the motion?
General Manager, I think it would be much clearer if we actually have it stated, because otherwise if people are looking at it subsequent, they're not going to have necessarily the memo that you're referencing. So,
okay, so are we moving? Well, the staff recommendation is those highlighted bits on that memo, is it?
Yep. So, with the exception of the first bullet point, which needs to be amended, to say that HCC supports the Development Contributions Working Group working with the government to refine elements of the bill relating to development contributions.
So, councillors, is there someone that's going to move that motion, which is the memo we got yesterday, with a change on the first bullet point, but pretty much the red on both? They'll put it up on the screen. So while that's happening, who presents our submissions?
So they go in writing from the Chief Executive, and then...
who speaks to them? at the select committee or where they go?
I'm not sure, actually.
We can request when we submit our submission if we wish to present.
Well, that's what's in the submission now. And it's there for a reason, not just because we like writing it down. Mm. We want someone to actually be there. Can I suggest, Your Worship, that depending on the time, that there should be, there may well be staff go, but there should be a representative. This is our council.
The reason I'm asking that is because I've certainly never presented a submission at a select committee. I've never been asked to, and I've never had a date provided to me. On occasion, there have been dates notified for other things, and in the past I've done those, or some other councillors have been, like, chairs. I remember Marika did one, and I think Dave, you did one, and Angela's done one. But the reason I'm asking is, in recent times, these major pieces of work, I want to know who actually speaks to them on our behalf, because these are city leadership presentations, elected people.
And if we want, Your Worship, to support you, that the politicians in Wellington take note of what we're saying, they're going to take far more note if they hear a mayor or a deputy mayor or a councillor speaking for that than they are if poor old Richard speaks.
I don't know. I guess it's a twofold question, isn't it? Do we at all present? Do staff present?
It's the stress of the job.
Does anyone present?
I'm not aware of it in my sort of time.
I'm not aware either. Blair, can you respond?
Well, I know there is a process. Well, there used to be a process because it was defined, certainly in the last council.
Certainly for the last local government bill, there was hearings held various parts around the country, and I recall there was a hearing.
I went in Hamilton, but yes. That was in the last council.
Correct.
Yeah, no, I'm talking about other stuff. So who goes?
We generally don't have representatives attend the select committee.
Why?
Often many of the submissions in the past have been that we don't wish to speak. It's been written. Okay. There has been the odd occasion where a specialist staff member, such as the building unit manager, may have attended a specialist submission. On the odd occasion, there's also been telephone submissions given by a senior staff member. But in most instances, council hasn't appeared at the hearing process.
So I have, in my time, once rejected a telephone submission. There's nothing compelling about a telephone submission.
They don't tend to.
Zero.
I agree.
Zero.
Sit there and listen.
Mm. Actually, I would go so far as to say it's probably less helpful than even neutral. Okay, so when are the select committee hearings?
Friday.
They're not necessarily advised much in advance sometimes, are they?
So I actually agree with the point both that Councillor McPherson and the Mayor made. I think we should make a very strongly worded comment that we want to attend and present our submission.
Yes. I suppose then that raises another issue, and look, it'll be for another council to decide all this. And that is why I continue to go on about the presentation of the submissions. Because if I was going to go and speak to them, I would certainly represent the views of the council, no question about that. But I would want to have confidence that the document we are presenting is in a form that is compelling.
Professional.
You know, compelling as in the arguments and the rationale. That's what I would be wanting to do, because I'm standing up and speaking for that, and it'll be the majority view, and that's perfectly fine. So, you know, that would be a big requirement, actually, because, you know, you're standing up for your city, and you've got to stand behind the document you've presented.
I take the point. So, and just to be clear, we are recommending in the submission that we do wish to speak.
I think, added to what you've just said, Your Worship, we also want the ability to actually tell our community what we're saying and why. So it's got to be something that if someone gets it, cop, look at it, they can, here in Hamilton, they can understand it.
They can understand it.
Yeah, I'm surprised we're having this discussion, because either we had a default that we automatically asked to speak, or and then we can always withdraw asking to speak, but at least we were in the queue. Secondly, it's covered, I think, by the delegation which talks about spokespersonships, and usually it's the mayor of the day and the relevant chair of the day, unless there's a unique topic and a subject that, you know, we collectively think another elected member would be better to present it. Obviously, we encourage select committees to come to Hamilton, come to the Waikato, of course, naturally. But I think in this specific case, it would be a given that the mayor was in a position, if she was available, to make an appropriate presentation, because I do think select committees do note if we, in this case, send our most senior individual, the leader of the city. There's a sort of a very strong psychology in terms of the leader of the city turning up. And then secondly, select committee members who read thousands of submissions and have thousands of words want to make sure that they get a very quick, succinct executive summary, and they certainly have that bullet point so they know exactly the guts of what Hamilton is saying, and then the mayor articulates that. I also think it's important with our own communication, be it through our website or our city news, from time to time we want to also emphasise where the city stands on something like this. And it's a matter of Lee Cowan and Chief Executive and the Mayor making some kind of call as to, you know, what rates, in terms of content. But I think that's also important, that picking up Dave's point, that we do share with our own community, let alone, of course. And then the other thing too, very special effort is made to smooth the local MPs in terms of, so they're not caught by any surprises, obviously, at what we're about to say at a select committee.
Right, there's the, is that the wording that you're recommending?
In respect to the development contributions, yes.
Right, and then the one below?
So just to be clear, so in the submission document, there's the recommendations up the front, and then the appendix has the table, which is repeats the recommendations and then has the explanation. So that's the recommendations are repeated, and the explanation comment text is the bottom set of bullet points there.
Okay. Does someone going to move that?
Oh, look, I'll move it for the sake of getting on the table, Your Worship, but I want to add something overall. This may not be exactly the right time, but there be a plain English summary encapsulating Council's arguments in respect of the main points it wishes to present.
So just add that up there then. Why don't you add that in?
Sorry?
Add that into that.
Yeah, I'll add it in for all of the bits, not just this. Yeah. DC's part of it, though.
No, for all of it. So it'll be that that counts, that a plain language, short summary of the Council submissions on this bill is made available to elected members and the public.
And the Select Committee.
And the Select Committee,
yeah. Can I clarify, is that something that would need to come back to Council for approval?
I think we've discussed the details. Mm-hmm. You guys write it up, so it's a summary of those. That's my view, personally, moving that.
Is your answer yes or no, then? So Sean, were you asking, does the plain English version come back to Council to be checked?
Does the plain English version need to come back to Council to be approved?
No, I think the clarity think is that there's enough direction to go away and prepare something.
Just had and made available to the public, councillors and the Select Committee, because then it'll go on the website. The other submissions do go on the website, but under what tab and how many clicks, I'm not sure. Do you know?
Sorry, what was the question?
How many tabs and clicks to get to our submissions on the website?
I couldn't tell you exactly.
Three, is it? Thank you, Mark. One tab and three clicks? Three clicks and you're there. Okay.
I think the point being, if we think we've got something important enough to say, we should be saying it face-to-face to people in Parliament who make the laws, and we should be telling the community and getting them on board where appropriate. Yep. That's what we're trying to do. There's no point just bureaucrats arguing between themselves.
Okay, so that's been moved by Councillor McPherson. Who's that going to be seconded by? Councillor Pascoe? I'm sure there's no debate on it.
Hopefully not.
Okay, so we're going to vote on it. All those in favour?
Aye.
Any against? None against. Okay. Okay, so this is just looking at the agenda. Thank you, Sean, and I know it's been topsy-turvy.
Did we pass that item three that Councillor Dave and I agreed on, 3.11? Have we passed?
Yeah.
Yeah, we did that, okay.
So we haven't passed the... So the other recommendations that the report we received, the recommendations in the report haven't been approved.
Okay.
Just a question on item D. Item E. How do we encourage the support of the MPs? We have that standard sort of paragraph in most of our submissions now that the local members of parliament be advised of and encouraged to support council's approved submission. How do we encourage them? Do we...
Are we write to them?
Just write to them and ask them to support it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So we don't actually schmooze them in any other way? No, to,
the mayor has chats to them too, and okay. It's helpful. No, it's multi.
Okay.
Right. No, it's everything.
Right. I mean, it's good to have that clause in there, but I just wonder what we actually do to get that encouragement, because there's no doubt if they go down to Wellington and are prepared to fight the battles for us down there, then we must get a lot more in the way
of traction. But Councillor Pascoe, remember this is a piece of government legislation and our local MPs are the government, are government members.
But they make mistakes too in terms of the legislation that they draw up.
Never. Never.
And our role is to help correct those mistakes.
Okay, so who's moving that? No one wants to move this thing on page.
Oh, I'll move it just to get it off the table.
Get it
off or on the table.
I'm
happy to second.
Yeah. Councillor Pascoe is seconding this. So this is, I guess, in some ways just a process. All those in favour?
Aye.
Against? Right.
Awesome.
So, Sean, I know you have spent a lot of time on this, and Mark, I know you have. Backwards and forwards, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sean.
All right, so the next... So, just a question here. It's 5:30, looking at the agenda. We have a couple more items to deal with in the public. And then we have public excluded, where we do have, you know, a couple of meaty items in that. So do you want to take a sort of a tea break now? Do you want to plough through the public one and get that finished with and then take a break? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. All right. Let's carry on then. Waikato okay. Plan, page item 9, page 185.
Sorry, what page you were?
185.
Thank you.
Okay, so you can take the report as read, Blair, and take questions. Okay, so questions, Councillor, to Blair on the Waikato plan. Councillor McPherson?
Yeah, I just want to get 6.6 on page 185, the population change.
Given the discussion we had about roading before and population effects on that, and that we've had this before, how realistic are we being in Waikato plan with our population projections, not just how much is growing in a gross way, but where it's growing as well? Are we still taking the median sort of point, or are we saying no? You know, North Hamilton is growing faster than we've ever thought, and it's got more three-car households than any other part of the country, which was certainly the case a few years ago. Don't know whether it's still the case. Things like that. Are we doing that sort of work that enables us to say where is it that growth is going to happen and services are going to be needed?
The Waikato plan, I guess, is trying to be realistic. It certainly identifies areas of high growth and those areas in decline. As you can imagine, that topic is somewhat sensitive to some of those councils. Some of those councils have a view as to their level of population change and demographic change, but I think the plan is trying to be realistic, and certainly some of the information and the charts do show areas of decline, particularly those areas to the southern part of the district. And it does recognise that around Hamilton, North Waikato, is areas of large population increase. And so it's trying to balance recognising that there's high growth, but there's also decline population, and how the plan can respond to those differing pressures in terms of the communities.
So does it sort of, thinking about Hamilton and surrounding area, does it give us the ability to relatively easily turn on the switch for, you know, more residential development areas if that's what's needed?
It's not so much the Waikato plan is not a future-proof sub-regional growth planning type strategy. So it's not talking about that type of responses.
Yeah, but is it putting obstacles in our way by saying that we need to keep all the green grassed land as pasture, for instance?
No, it's not.
Yeah.
No, not at all.
Thanks.
Councillor Mallett?
I don't remember. Sorry, I didn't remember putting my hand up. My apologies.
Okay.
Just an automatic reaction. Every new item, he sticks his hand up.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. No, I do remember what it was. Sorry. There it is.
Right.
Just,
always has a question.
49, the cost of the plan, $147,000.
Yes.
Now, it says it's budgeted for 14-15, which has been.
Yes.
So, presumably, we budgeted 147 for that year, used it all up or not, or... I just want to know, how is it being accounted for now?
So the cash contributions from the councils were collected through to June 2015, and the Waikato Plan project has an overall budget of just under $1.2 million. And those monies were held centrally.
So we prepaid in effect?
Effectively, yes. Yes.
Okay, so is it going to, like, there's no likelihood that you'll be wanting more?
Joint Committee has been given repeated information from the independent project advisor that the monies required up to the consultation process will be met from within that overall envelope.
Thank you.
Councillor O'Leary?
But so just to follow on from that, so that $1.2 million, at the end of that, we get a document?
Yes, that's correct, yes. So that's the cost to produce a Waikato plan following consultation with the community that can then be utilised by the Waikato region as its voice in terms of the various issues that the plan covers.
So what are the fundamental differences between, because I heard you respond to Councillor McPherson's question and you said, I can't actually remember because it was only a few minutes ago and I'm hungry. Something about
it's not a sub-regional growth strategy,
but it is a sub-regional document.
It's a regional document.
Well, a regional document. So what is the difference between this and Future Proof?
Future Proof is about the three councils, Hamilton, Waikato, Waipa, agreeing where growth will occur, because we're all growth councils, and the sequencing and time of that growth across the various parts of those three council areas. The Waikato plan is about identifying across the entire Waikato region where we have areas where we can speak with one voice collectively with all our key stakeholders, and principally the government, major government departments, major community organisations, how we can collectively work together for the benefit and betterment of our communities.
But a lot of that language, Blair, to be, with all due respect, is in Future Proof, and NZTA have been involved in Future Proof. Obviously, regional councils have been involved in Future Proof. So there must be some cross work going on with Future Proof and this work.
Look, I think it's fair to say that in the future, and this will be something for the new council to consider in the future, where does the Future Proof growth strategy sit in relation to the Waikato plan? I think that same question is relevant to the Waikato Means Business Economic Development Strategy and the Waikato Story. So where do all these documents sit? But I do know that Future Proof is around just three councils. The Waikato plan covers all of the councils. And the Waikato plan has DHB, has the National Infrastructure Unit from Treasury, has a number of other key government departments, so it's a much wider reach than future-proof. Future-proof is specifically around planning for growth and where and at what rate that we agree growth should occur in communities. The Waikato Plan is far wider than that. The Waikato Plan has a, councils recall under the old Local Government Act, the four well-beings, social, cultural, economic, environmental, plus a spatial element. So it's a far wider brief than future-proof.
So after the completion of this $1.2 million document, I'm being a little bit naughty saying it like that, but there's obviously going to be investment required from councils to deliver on the projects that are in that document.
I think there'll be significant investment required by a range of stakeholders, and much of that will be non-local government. It'll actually be leveraging central government expenditure, and bearing in mind central government expenditure is considerably more than local government expenditure across the region in a variety of areas. So it's about leveraging the expenditure of all central government and all those other key organisations, community organisations that operate in the region. And there will be some local government expenditure, but much of that will actually be leveraging and aligning existing budgets that we already spend, but aligning those. For example, an initiative around cycleways and connecting up the cycleways across the Waikato region, the river ride. It's about aligning all those budgets of the councils to a common goal. Many of those councils will have those cycleway type budgets in their programs. It's about lining those up in a programmed way to deliver an overall solution. So I think, long answer, councillor, it's not about councils having to put their hand in the pocket pole of things. It's about how do we work to leverage the combined spend of all the key stakeholders in our communities for a better outcome for the region.
And where does the Waikato story fit in? Is that a project under this plan, or is that another separate thing?
I'd like to know as well.
Yeah.
Yes, that's a very good question, and that's something that was raised at the last joint committee of the Waikato plan. Yeah, it's around.
So what's the answer?
The answer is conversations have just started. And that is something that the view at the moment is that as this Waikato plan moves into an implementation phase, that how this Waikato plan is implemented and how Waikato story and how the Waikato Means Business implemented may well need to come together, Your Worship.
But who's doing the Waikato story? What is that, another plan? Or I've only heard people in the community talk about it. I actually don't know anything about it.
So the Waikato story is an initiative of the Waikato Means Business, which is the economic development strategy
under the Merrill Forum.
It's an initiative from the Merrill Forum. It's now got its own governance group and its own process. But yes, so it's a process that's kind of, and the Waikato story, I'm not close to that, councillor, but it's certainly.
Neither am I.
Sounds like yes, minister.
But there's certainly been identified as an opportunity for that to language to be aligned, the messaging to be aligned, and that's certainly been the conversation of the last joint committee.
But what actually is it?
The Waikato story?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it a book? Is it a comic?
I haven't.
I don't know.
I can't speak with detail, but I understand it's to try and explain the proposition.
It's a narrative of the Waikato.
Yeah.
But what does that mean?
That's not helpful at all.
Do you have something to add, Kel?
I've seen a draft.
It's Gordon's next project.
So I've seen a draft video.
It's a video, but it is
exactly as the CEO said. It's trying to sell the proposition of what the Waikato is in terms of a punchy video.
Are you aware of the New Zealand story?
Yes.
I've got my own story.
No, well, there is.
It's quite short.
I think
I was born here. I am
executive director. This highlights probably the need to actually bring council up to speed on the various facets of what the regional plans are. I think there's definitely a gap, and I think there's not only a gap in what the councillors understand, there's also a gap in what the officers are able to provide, so I think we need to close both sets of gaps.
You haven't answered that question at all, but...
No, I just admitted that we don't have an answer for
the
councillor.
Well, I think the answer to that question is that we don't actually know. No. We haven't actually seen it, but I do have some questions if you've finished, and then I'll go to the Deputy Mayor. Because Councillor Gallagher and I do attend this meeting, and I have to tell you, I have questions, so that might give you an indication. What I want to know is what happened. You gave us a bit of an update on a summary document, about four,
4 months ago?
Mm-hmm. In March.
Yes. And what I want to know is, where did that feedback go and why did it not materialise into the 171 pages that came to the Joint Committee? Because councillors were quite firm about the input they wanted to give on that. Mm-hmm.
So that
and then 171 pages turned up.
So that feedback was given to the through to the project team, the project group, through the chief executives, through the chief executive group, and ultimately through the joint committee. I note that council was one. We're not the sole voice or determinant of the project. But what I would add is that the feedback that council gave, and I've gone back and checked the feedback, excluding the brevity and shortness of the document. A number of those points and actions have been captured in the Waikato plan. What I would acknowledge, Your Worship, is that, and you will have seen in my report, that the joint committee, the most recent joint committee meeting, gave considerable feedback on the draft, including the length of the document. And there is a process occurring right now to undertake a fundamental edit of the document, to thoroughly refine it down, to make it shorter, but also in addition to that, to produce an entirely new 20 to 30 page summary version of the document, which will also reflect what HCC's feedback was back at the start. So what we have sought and desired, this process will deliver in terms of the current editing and production of a highly customised summary document.
Okay, so we're going to have 171 pages or thereabouts to speak with one voice.
No. No, I
and
would
then
hope
we're going to have a 20 to 30 page summary of that. Let's say it'll be 130 pages.
I think it's fair to say
speak with one voice.
There'll be a longer document.
and a comic/coffee book.
No, I think there'll be a longer document, which is a more of a technical document, but considerably edited down from what is in the link that you've seen, and a far more refined summarised version, which is designed to be the document that would be where the primary engagement occurs with central government. Key organisations, key government organisations, key stakeholders in the community. It'll be the 20 to 30 page document, which will be that one.
And when will this council, and I mean this council, get to see those sort of documents? And the reason I raise that is because, despite your report saying it's been under development from 2015-16, it's actually been under development from 2013?
Some early work was probably 2013.
Yeah, all the gathering of data, 2 years of data mining. When will this council, who has been the one predominantly on the journey, get to see those drafts prior to October? Because I think that's actually quite a relevant matter, and I note that Councillor Gallagher's nodding about that, given that this council has provided input into, or apparently provided input into that.
Mm.
When will that be?
So I raised that very issue yesterday, Your Worship, at the Chief Executive's meeting on this, and I understand early September we will get visibility at an executive level of the revised versions. There is going to be a meeting of the Joint Committee to have a chance to have a look at those documents later September, so I would anticipate sometime early September, this council, I'll be able to circulate a copy for this council's information.
So that could be on the briefing list for September's briefing?
Yes, it could be.
Okay. I also want to know how all this works. Waikato Plan, future-proof, I understand. The Regional Economic Development Strategy, which apparently does have an action of the Waikato story, although I can tell you they have also not seen the Waikato story. And then we've got the Tourism Opportunities Plan. So who, or what of these various groups, because there's a myriad of them, is actually writing on a blackboard, a whiteboard, a chart that tries to bring all these together? Who's responsible? Who's taking responsibility for that? Is it the project person? Was it someone else? Who is it?
Look, the answer is, at a chief executive group level, as of yesterday, they have acknowledged that there is an issue here, which was also acknowledged by the joint committee at the last meeting, when the joint committee was talking about the June or July joint committee meeting, talked about language consistency alignment between those three? Mm-hmm. Are they, the Joint Committee tasked the chair of the Waikato Plan and the project director to have conversations with representatives from Waikato Mean Business, Waikato Story? That's occurred. The chief executives acknowledge it's a problem. So there is no solution yet, Your Worship, but it's certainly been acknowledged we need to find a way, because they, all three have been developed somewhat separately. And in fact, in a perfect world, the Waikato Plan would have been the first strategy developed, and then the economic development would have been an outcome of that process. Of course, the opposite has occurred.
But that feedback, the risk of... That feedback was given from day one in the Joint Committee. So that's being picked up now, a couple of years later. Okay, good to know. Good to know, because I think the briefing should also include a visual diagram of how these all work together, and, you know, sort of the accountability model, I guess. Otherwise, we're going to have, you know, that they're not all going to join up, are they?
No.
And so it would be appropriate then for us to also add on this Waikato Story. You're going to, someone is going to find out about the Waikato Story and bring it to us for comment, I presume, draft and comment and input?
We will find out some more.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, Deputy Mayor.
Yes, I can be a little helpful around the Waikato Story.
A little helpful.
Listening to you has reminded me that about 3 years ago, I got called into a discussion, I think with Saatchi's, over the Waikato Story that had been promoted by the Waikato Regional Council. And the idea was that this was going to be a filmed documentary type marketing tool that could be used to promote the Waikato as a sound economic base. And I recall at the time you and I had a brief discussion about the value of investing something like $100,000 from the city's perspective to assist in the development of that. So I believe that I had an interview on the ninth floor
with Saatchi and Saatchi
2 or 3 years ago, so long ago I've almost forgotten, but certainly Regional Council was pushing it. I still have huge hesitations, all very well to have beautiful pictures and images,
video.
But what do you actually do with it? How do you use that to influence corporates around New Zealand to relocate to the Waikato? So I would like you to see where has this idea progressed. Has any money been spent on it?
I think definitely the Regional Council has taken responsibility for
development. Regional Council drove that idea.
Yes, they
and,
did.
I mean, that it's they've been doing it, and we heard from the General Manager that he's actually seen a draft of it. Do you call a video a draft?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's fair to say it doesn't have a lot of visibility at the sub-regional meetings.
But it has been shown in public meetings and presentations.
Yes, I think probably it's not a topic of discussion at the mayoral forum, at the likes of LAS. So it's somewhat in a process somewhat off to the side.
I think, Your Worship, right. This has been done elsewhere, and what they showed me was images of another region somewhere else.
Right.
Okay.
It's a gift that
the ticket day.
No, right? We sucked these guys in before we sucked you guys in.
But, you know, and they're probably all the same.
For millions.
So they'll just change it to our name. Okay, so if there's no other questions here, what we might do is
receive
the report. And I'm happy to move. We received the report that at the September briefing, or it sounds like it has to be September, the September briefing, councillors are to be provided with a draft of the Waikato Plan and the Waikato Story. Right, I think that's all we
can
need.
And along with that, can we have an idea of costs that have been spent on it, yes, and what's left to be done?
Yes.
And
a timeline of to complete the
and some names of who's responsible for things.
Yes, okay. Some detail around the project timeline, cost and management. Who's
responsible? Like New Zealand, like the City News. Still waiting.
Okay, so
I'm waiting for that too. I had a bet on that as well.
Councillors, I'm happy to move that. Seconded by the Deputy Mayor. All right, so we might just show of hands. All those in favour, raise your hand. Any against? Any against? No?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Blair, for that update. Right, the next item is item 11, page 201.
Me?
Councillor O'Leary, this is your
yes.
matter.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'll do them separately, I guess.
Right.
So item one, the Hamilton Central City Safety Plan annual report. So that was presented to the committee. I'll move that that be received by council.
Seconded by Councillor Wilson. Any discussion, councillors? Okay, we'll vote on that now. All those in favour, raise your hand. I think that's everyone. Any against?
We're having too many unanimous votes.
We are.
Next one, thanks.
Item two, the last remaining governance policy review, the citizens initiated referendum policy, and that was to be retained. I'll move that be received.
Right, all those in favour, raise your hand. Any against?
And that staff be instructed never to bring it up again.
I don't think we can do that, Councillor McPherson. Number three.
Item three, Trade Waste and Wastewater Bylaw 2016 Deliberation Adoption Report. I'll move that be received by Council.
Right, seconded by Councillor Young. All those in favour, raise your hand. Any against? Okay.
And lastly, second to last, sustainability principles, and that's that council adopt the sustainability principles as in the report. I will move that be received.
Seconded by Councillor Forsyth. Now, can I just ask a question of the general manager in this area? So that would be you, Sean. When I looked at the sustainability panel's terms of reference, I did note that their only function was to actually do that, review that report, provide that report. Now that they've completed that and this resolution sort of finalises, I guess, that work and this has been, be adopted by the council, the terms of reference seem to me to be kind of like at an end. And it may be that there is in the future another one, but it wouldn't be because these terms of reference no longer apply.
Correct.
So have I got that right?
Yes. So for practical reasons, we thought if there were to be a new terms of reference, that would be a matter for the new council.
Right, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, so, perhaps then we just leave it for the new council, but I just highlighted
well,
that because...
it needs to be drawn to their attention that's an action that may be required.
It's captured in the actions list of the strategy policy.
Well, I wondered if... I'm just testing here. If we resolve then that the council no longer, that the sustainability advisory panel was no longer required, then that would then trigger, because then that completes it and finishes it, and then that will force then a discussion at, the next council. Otherwise, it might just get rolled over that people probably look at.
It's on the action list.
Things on the action list.
I take a contrary view that
we
need the sustainability panel because it's an external audit of our activity, but it would be a note that in probably... at some stage, there will be an interaction with the sustainability panel to discuss with them revised.
Well, they'll have to be set up again, I guess.
Could it not be a note that we note the sustainability panel has been completed?
Yes.
That it not be required. I think that's an unfortunate.
Yes, okay.
Word.
Okay. The sustainability advisory panel's
brief is. That's what it was it?
Function has been completed. I'm happy to...
The initial function.
Yes.
Yes. Because the other thing about that advisory panel was it was set up in the last council and just carried on because it had work to do. It wasn't like a new thing. Yeah, okay. Short, so can we put that wording in? I'm happy to include... Councillor O'Leary, are you happy to... I just raised that. Are you happy to include that?
Yes, wording? That's fine. Yeah.
I have a question. Relation to the actions, right? One of the actions we were told about was that there'd be annual monitoring around December. Is that there's no action plan here as part of the resolution? I just want to check with that.
It's a resolution from the prior March Strategy and Policy Committee, I think.
So it's on the list.
That was part of the resolution.
The date of it was there. I had a feeling that the actual date wasn't.
the date was, so it's a stop take as at December.
That's right. So I remember reading that.
And that be referred back to council. There was one aspect that was missing in that. Where does it go? You can do a stock take and then it sits in a file.
No, but I think I remember reading that in the minutes, the last minutes it was approved in your committee, Councillor O'Leary, which said that.
Yeah, the stock take, but where does it get taken?
I guess to S&P, is it?
Is it?
To strategy and policy.
The resolution is to bring it back to the committee.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just say what I want to check. Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay.
Look, to be honest, and it's a bit late in the day, I would actually, on this one, I'm happy to take this as in front of me. What I'd like to do is get some clarity, maybe at the next S&P, as to the future role, the current and future role of sustainability panel. And I'd be more comfortable with that. Okay, so I'm open-minded, but I'd just like us to adopt this, and then probably the appropriate staff would just bring us a report as to the any other work that the sustainability panel may be in action, but that we then hand that over to the new council.
Your Worship, they all finish with the end of the term anyway, the new governance structure.
This one was a carryover because it had worked
from the last
term to this one.
Because then you have a new governance,
structure.
The new council decided what they wanted it to be.
I mean, my preference would be just to be silent on that and wait for a discussion of the new governance structure and a new training for those of you who are here.
Look, I'm relaxed. I just simply raise it.
Yeah, it's not.
All right. Well, look, I'm happy to leave it as it is. I just simply raise it, but it's got a note now. They've got a note about it. So sorry, Councillor O'Leary, I just raised it. So you're just going to move the recommendation
as is. Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Who seconded that?
Yeah.
Councillor Forsyth did. So if there's no other discussion, right? All those in favour, raise your hands. Any against? No? Councillor Mallett is against. Next one.
Do you want the strategy back?
Last one, Your Worship, is item 5, the update on the HCC strategic plans. And that's
right. Moved by you, seconded by who's seconding that? I'll second it. Okay, any discussion? All those in favour?
I do have a question.
Yes.
Why is the Active Hamilton strategy being deleted?
That was at the S&P meeting. So, Councillor Forsyth, you missed that. But the General Manager can just remind you.
The discussion at the committee pretty much has been overtaken by the regional sports facilities plan on the facilities side of physical activity. And then Sport Waikato have been doing the moving towards 2025, which is a regional strategy which has included sporting groups and also the local authorities through the mayoral forum and also staff representation groups, which is probably a lot more a holistic sort of approach to sports facilities, but also sports programs and targeting priorities that are coming out of Sport New Zealand's community sports strategy. So priorities around youth, around females, around Māori population, deprived populations, and also rural communities as well. So essentially, the Active Hamilton strategy had its time. To be honest, our actions on that, a lot of them have been completed, and with Sport New Zealand moving in a little bit of a different direction, it was felt that it's probably had its time, and it's probably something that the new council should have a look at going forward.
How do we ensure that happens? Because there are some glaring issues that are still outstanding. For instance, the disparity in costs between using council facilities for different sports, different types of sports, is one. I mean, the Sport New Zealand is now focusing on high performance to the exclusion of a lot of other things, reducing some of their community programs. Where's the? I don't want to have a debate about that here now. But where do we look at that issue? How do we ensure it?
But when the new council forms, right? If that's an issue that's really particularly important, right, to the new council, then that will get on like a strategy and policy work program and stuff like that.
So that particular issue is on
the strategy.
That particular issue that you just brought up, Councillor McPherson, it came up at a previous strategy and policy committee. It might have been a council meeting around the annual plan being approved. That's on the community forum subcommittee agenda. So I think there's an opportunity to have that particular discussion around fees and charges. I think the wider discussion would be for the new council to have a look at when it comes in.
So why do we are we removing our strategies now? Mm. Why aren't we referring them on to the new council?
No, because
instead of leaving a blank page.
Well, I think what we can say is what happened. This is a recommendation from S&P that was all debated out, and that was the resolution made.
Mm.
If there are councillors, and we've actually just resolved that one, but I'm sort of happy to revisit it. But if there are councillors who don't want this council to adopt that recommendation, then they need to put an amendment, mm. and it will be voted on, because that's sort of where we're at.
Possibly refer it to the next council.
So we have actually finished that one, so we have voted on that one already. If you wish, I'm happy to take it, go back again and re-vote on it if you want to put an amendment, but you'd need to put it on.
Well, I'd like to try amendment exactly the wording that Lance just suggested, the Act of Hamilton strategy be referred to the incoming council.
Mm.
Right, so is that all right with councils? I mean, technically, of course, we voted on it. We shouldn't go back, but I'm trying to be collegial here.
Yeah, we can revisit, can't we, at full council meeting?
Yeah, no, but we've already actually voted just now on it.
We are full council.
We haven't.
Yes, we have. Item 4, we voted on.
Yes. Are you talking about 4 or item 5?
No, we're up to 5 now, this one here.
Yeah, sorry, what are you that's what I'm discussing.
Yeah, we're talking about item 5.
Yes, but you're talking about B on 4.
I'm talking about five.
I'm with you.
Number 5.
Sorry,
yeah.
Right, yes. Yeah. Okay, so we've got a mover and a seconder. You got an amendment?
Yeah, the Act of Hamilton strategy be referred to the incoming council.
Mm.
Right, is there a seconder for that? Right. Do people want to speak on it? No, I think it was my fault, Councillor King. I confused people. Forget everything that I said about we've already voted, because we haven't.
I unfortunately
didn't put the glasses on when I should have. We're up to item 5. It's a recommendation from the Strategy and Policy Committee. That recommendation was moved and seconded. We just had a discussion about that. An amendment is now going to be put. Okay, so I confused everyone. I'm sorry about that.
I was at the Strategy and Policy Committee, but can someone refresh me? Because there's no paperwork here and I just need to come up to speed. I would have been right with it last meeting.
Can you update?
Look, I can. We didn't actually have a discussion at the last meeting on this. It was at the bottom of the report and it went through because we were focused on the sustainability principles. I honestly can't remember. I think it's been on the list to delete for quite some time. I don't recall us actually talking about it.
It was a paragraph
but it's been, yeah, it's been in sort of the list to delete for quite a while. And I think what Lance has said, I mean, I'm actually relaxed either way, but what Lance has said, and I've just looked at the action plan, I mean, majority of the projects were completed mid-2013. So, I'm relaxed. I'd be happy to remove the motion if that's what, if that's going to make things easier.
We'll be voting on that. We need to follow the correct process. So
what are we voting on?
So just to update you, it was in the report that went to S&P, just to update you, Lance had a paragraph in that report, he spoke about it, exactly sort of what he just said before, and then council voted. This is a recommendation coming through from that committee. If councillors in this forum don't want to accept that recommendation, they can. And Councillor McPherson has put a motion not to, and to do something different.
No, we didn't have a discussion.
Okay.
But do I understand that this strategy has run its course and finished its job?
According to the General Manager, yes.
So you'll vote against?
It's not necessarily the case. Well, I suppose I'll hear during debate.
Yeah.
That'll probably guide me. Yeah. I'm just a little bit blind, but...
Okay.
I'll try and listen during debate.
So we've got...
Catch up.
Perhaps if you put the motion here and the amendment, good, right? So, Councillor McPherson, do you wish to speak?
Sorry, could I just see who seconded the amendment?
Councillor Forsyth.
So, sorry, Councillor McPherson, we're going to be doing this, to get...
Look, the only point that I really want to make is that, yes, we've done a number of things... I don't think everything was in the strategy. We've done a number of things and time has moved on.
My problem is that I believe there's still a need for an active Hamilton strategy with, but we need to look again at what should be in it for the next few years. So all of the amendment does is say, okay, we're not going to do anything more this council, but we're going to make sure it's on the list for the next council to have a look at. And they can decide what they want to do with it, what they want to put in it, if they want to reject it or whatever. That's all.
But I might, I'm just going to speak for the motion because I've supported that. One of the things this council has been very good at is going through a whole pile of policies and tidying up a whole pile of stuff. Now, of course, that's not a reason to just, you know, remove things. But I think the council's actually done a really, really good job of that. And part of that process has been to say, well, have we done everything we're supposed to have done? Do we need it? Do we not need it? You know, is it relevant? Not relevant. And listening to the general manager and reading the report and the Strategy and Policy Committee, that's exactly where this one is at. So that's why I'm supporting the motion. Now, in respect of do we still need some form of strategy, that may well be the case. But what I do know is when that strategy was formed, there was nothing, no regional strategy. No. Sport Waikato hadn't done any of that work, and that is a really good piece of work. It might be that the new council, as part of their process, get a real update on that and then work out where to go from here. But in my view, this is tidying up and saying we finished it. There might be something new in the future, but it's done. So that's why I'm supporting the motion. But I understand the sentiment behind the sport, you know, the need for focus in the city on sport and its issues. Anyone else want to speak?
You just yes. Quickly. Look, I think there is still a place for a Hamilton strategy, whether it's, we call it a Hamilton strategy or a Hamilton plan about activity, and even more so with the fact that we do have a regional plan and Sport Waikato has been driving that. I think there is still a place for a plan for what's Hamilton's responsibility, what do we have to do to maintain an active city, and it might just come down to facilities, it might come down to costs or you know, any other matter, but I think there's a place for a plan, and I think if we can keep it on the radar and let the incoming council decide whatever it is that they want to do with it, whether they continue with a plan or a strategy or whether they don't, whether they think that Sport Waikato or Sport New Zealand is doing enough. But I think to take it out completely, it's very easy for it to be overlooked. And activity, those of you that are on the DHB, you understand the importance of having an active and a healthy community. Yeah, I think we still have a role to play. We have a big role to play as a city.
Anyone else to speak? Okay, we're going to vote. All those in favour of the amendment, raise your hand.
Those for the amendment are Councillors Chesterman, Gallagher, Forsyth, Pascoe, McPherson, Tooman and Wilson.
Those against?
Worship the Mayor, Hardacre, Councillors Young, O'Leary, King and Mallet. The amendment is declared carried.
Okay, all those in favour of the amendment, because it's now the motion?
Motion.
Any against?
Right. Councillor Mallet dissenting.
Okay, no other matters there, so we're now moving to the council minutes. I'll move the council minutes for the 30th of June. Seconded by the Deputy Mayor. Any discussion? I'm going to put those. All those in favour, raise your hand. Any against? No? Okay, thank you. All right, so we're now moving to public excluded. So I'll move that we go into public excluded, seconded by the Deputy Mayor. Okay, all those in favour?
Sorry, just the process you were.
Yes.
Are we not having a break now?
Yes, we are. Oh, I'm moving into public excluded so that the video man can go. So all those in favour?
So,
any against?
No, can I ask?
Huh? Yes.
Why is C4, is there still something coming on that?
No, C4 was the public excluded part of the growth report pulled from the open minute, open agenda.
Didn't you get the CEO's bleating email? Team's been under pressure.
They were under pressure.
Not ready.
Not ready.
Okay, so...
Bleaty.
Sorry, councillors, so just that we're tidy here.
Bleat.
All those in favour?
Aye.
Any against? No. Okay, right. Okay, thank you. So we're now having a...